My name is Dr. Andrew Elder from Edinburgh in Scotland, and I'm a visiting associate professor here at Stanford University in California, supporting the work of the Stanford 25 Clinical Skills Teaching Program. I'm going to review a neglected but often important part of the respiratory examination, and that's the examination of the trachea or trachea. There are three cartilages in the neck which one should be familiar with: the hyoid, which is not visible on clinical examination, the thyroid cartilage, which is visible and forms the prominent Adam's apple in a man but maybe less prominent in a woman, and the cricoid cartilage, which we're going to be interested in today, which is usually difficult to see clinically but can be palpated. The neck can be a sensitive part of the anatomy to examine, so always explain to the patient exactly what you're going to do and enlist their help. So Beverly, I'm just going to be feeling your trachea now. I hope it's not uncomfortable, and if you'll let me know if it is. Okay. And I can, just by light palpation here, I can feel the thyroid cartilage or Adam's apple. If I come inferiorly here, I can feel a hollow. That's the cricothyroid ligament, or sometimes called cricothyroid membrane. And then here, I can run my finger over a ridge that's the cricoid cartilage. So that's the basic surface anatomy of the part of the neck that we're interested in examining today. So in order, the three signs we're going to look at today are tracheal deviation, the cricosternal distance, and tracheal descent on inspiration. I'm going to show you two different ways to assess whether or not the trachea is central or displaced. In both, we use the sternocleidomastoid muscle as a point of reference. In the first method, which may be a little more uncomfortable for your patient, one attempts to define whether or not you can place a finger between the trachea, round about the level of the thyroid cartilage, between the trachea and the sternocleidomastoid muscle. And you can see that I can there, with light pressure, insinuate my finger. Similarly, on this side, I can get a finger in there. Were the trachea deviated significantly to the right side, I would find it very difficult or impossible to insinuate my finger between the sternocleidomastoid and the trachea, and much easier to do so on the left side. The second method by which we can assess whether the trachea is central or deviated again involves using the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and more particularly their sternal heads, as a point of reference. One should place two fingers on either side of these muscles and simply then run your middle finger gently down the trachea. Using your other two fingers as points of reference, you'll be able to see whether or not the trachea, as in this case, is central or deviated to the right or left. The second sign that we're going to consider is the cricosternal distance. That is the distance between the cricoid cartilage, which we've defined earlier, and the sternal notch. This is a useful sign in patients who have chronic obstructive pulmonary disease or other lung conditions that cause hyperinflation. In hyperinflation, the cricosternal distance may be significantly reduced. In our normal patient here today, I can measure the cricosternal distance simply by palpating the cricoid and then counting how many fingers I can insinuate between it and the sternal notch. And as you can see, I can comfortably insinuate three fingers there. In patients with hyperinflation of the lungs, that distance will be reduced, sometimes down to only one finger or even less. In some patients with chronic pulmonary disease that causes hyperinflation, a further sign can be found in the trachea, and we call that tracheal descent on inspiration. In normal individuals, in quiet respiration, there is no significant movement of the trachea in inspiration or expiration. In patients with advanced hyperinflation due to vigorous diaphragmatic movement and subsequent movement of the mediastinum, there may be a vigorous descent of the trachea. Again, this can be easily elicited by popping a finger onto the trachea just below the cricoid and watching what happens as the patient breathes in and out. In marked cases, the trachea will descend vigorously, almost pulling one's finger inferiorly.
The preceding program is copyrighted by the Board of Trustees of the Leland Stanford Junior University. Please visit us at med.stanford.edu.